Well, hey, everyone. One of the things we need in this country is term limits for members of Congress. It's a good policy. We have people like Pelosi that have been there for decade after decade. They're more interested in advancing themselves than they are delivering results for you. So we need term limits. Problem is, Congress is never going to enact this. As president, I'll lead the efforts to bring about term limits through the states.
Now, first off, welcome back to the program. Dana Loesch here with you. Bottom of this second hour, that's Florida Governor Ron DeSantis. Now, full disclosure, I'm going to lay this out there because somebody's bound to get mad. I disagree with this. Full disclosure, I disagree with it, and I still like DeSantis as my primary selection because we live in a republic and not a monarchy, and we've all had family members that have either bled or died for the preservation of that choice, correct? So he's my pick for the primary. I disagree with term limits. Very, very passionately disagree with term limits. And here's why. And I've talked about this before. And I understand what he's saying. And I think that he makes some good, I think that he makes some good points. I understand the position that some have wherein they say, look, the checks and balances that the founders enshrined in the Constitution have been twisted and manipulated and turned and bastardized to the point to where they do not serve the same function that they did prior to the twisting and the turning and the manipulation. I understand that. Which is also why I disagree with doing more of it. Now, here's my point. I agree with what the founders wrote in the Federalist Papers about term limits. And they liked the idea of rotation for a while. I think it was Madison and Hamilton, etc. They kicked around the idea of term limits, you know, and rotation and things like this. And they had a very... I think it was Federalist 70 and Federalist 52, where they got into a lot of this. But ultimately, long story short, they realized that the term limit should be the voter. The voter makes the determination as to when they believe that a politician enough is enough. They're no longer serving the purpose of the people. Thus, they have to go. I'm very wary of giving government any more power or responsibility that initially was designed to rest with the free people itself. It's supposed to be our discretion. It is our decision as to whether or not someone remains in office for a certain period of time or not, or whether they go. I mean, that's what our vote is. It's the consent to be governed, the consent of this individual to represent us in Congress. And I understand too, you got the Pelosi's out there. You got all these people that have been in Congress for like longer than some of us have been alive. I completely understand that. But a people's failure to do their duty, their due diligence as citizens, is not a case for government involvement. Wherever the people fail, it has always been exploited by government to grow itself. If the people fail in charity, then the government expands and it promotes this concept of welfare, and it does it horribly. It just spreads around mediocrity, and it's a shameful form of bare minimum charity that private individuals could do so much better themselves. But wherever it is that people fail, that's when government always takes the opportunity, exploits it to grow itself, to enrich itself. And this, in my opinion, and again, I based my assessment on what the founders wrote. I've read Federalist Papers. I've read Anti-Federalist Papers. I've read arguments on this. And I tend to agree that this is a responsibility of the voter. I mean, think of how much of our power we have just ceded over to the federal government. And this is another of them. Now, as I said, as I was saying, I understand the argument that, well, people like Nancy Pelosi have been in there way too long. I agree. But the failure by the people to remove her, is that a call for more government? Because here's what, I think it was Hamilton, when he was writing in the Federalist Papers about this, and one of the arguments that he had put forward is that, well, if you have term limits, you're going to have the same special interests that are in D.C. no matter what. And that's going to greatly empower those people, the unaccountable influences in government that really write a lot of the stuff. Let's be honest about it. I mean, look at the healthcare law. How much of that was written by lobbyists? See what I'm saying? You are strengthening the power of the unaccountable, because more people that come in, they're not going to have the established reputations. They're not going to have the understanding of how to navigate. They're not going to know the procedures on the floor, et cetera, et cetera. And they're going to end up being kind of second string to these special interests that are unaccountable to the voters that are there in D.C. I get that. And I think that that's a good argument. I mean, like I said, I understand, you know, what some say in that they can't trust some of these bad representatives to be removed by way of vote. But that's not an argument to give that job to the government. I don't think that, well, because the people failed to do their job, I guess we should have the government handle it. Because that's what this is. The problem is bad government, correct? So why are we giving it more power? That is what you're doing with term limits. You're ceding your authority as a voter over to the government. I mean, some people, I want to stay in there longer, if I'm being honest. People like Louis Gohmert. People like Chip Roy. People like Thomas Massie. I want them to stay in there longer. I want Thomas Massie to stay in there as long as he wants to. He's quite good. Some of these people, I don't want to stay in there. But that doesn't mean we outsource our responsibility as citizens and as voters, our civic duty. We just sign it away to the government because we can't be prevailed upon to undertake it ourselves. That's the argument here. So I am completely against term limits, 1,100% against term limits. I don't think that it is a good position. I don't think it's one that we should be advocating right now. And I don't think that we should make voters easy in apathy. And that's not a slight on voters. It's just an observation of reality. I mean, you had how many registered Republicans didn't go out and vote last election? How many registered Republicans don't go out and vote in their municipal elections? I mean, when I look at the numbers, it's hard for me to drum up an apology about apathetic voters when I see how few vote in some of the most important elections. I mean, one of the reasons that Republicans lose elections is because not enough of them go out to vote. In Georgia, we lost that special Senate election because not enough Republicans turned out to vote, especially Marjorie Taylor Greene's county. And just a quick note on that, she was saying, well, this is Trump country, but they didn't come out and vote when it mattered to save the Senate. And they also didn't come out and vote in 2020. I was looking at the numbers on that. So I don't know. Maybe she needs to go get out the vote there a little bit more. I've been in Georgia. I've been on the ground there helping to canvass for votes and get out the vote and all that stuff and raise awareness and encourage people to go and do their civic duty. And I was talking to people who just didn't want to go vote. So it's perfectly reasonable to remark on the apathy of the voter. And that is not a case to be made in defense of government intrusion in the matters of citizens' responsibilities. So this is why I disagree with the governor here. This is like one of my first big disagreements with him. And here's the thing. I disagree with there's not a politician in office that I don't disagree with somebody on something. Folks, that's the nature of it. Do you agree with your spouse on everything? I mean, yes, ladies, I hear you. Well, I'm always right, so yes, he should. I get you. I get it. Like, for instance, in my house, we have a long-running debate. I think that I have a more novel way of approaching the loading of the dishwasher. Now my husband disagrees. Also in my home, when I went to hang something, I really, you know, put a lot of faith in the old trusty eyeball, right? Not my husband. He literally has a thing on a tripod, and then he has a level thing, and the thing on the tripod, like, shoots a laser out at something, and he's got this level thing, and he brings out all this equipment that he has for literally hanging in photo. For instance, I went to go hang something in my son's room. I ordered it for Christmas for him last year. And I was just going to eyeball it in the middle of the, you know, I'm a pretty good judge of that. I was just going to put it in the middle of the wall. It's a big wall. I'm just going to put it in the middle of the wall. Nope. That will not do. My husband had to get out the tripod and the thing with the bubble, the level thing in there. That's, by the way, that's like we have that. It's so remedial and we use it and it's fascinating to me. Anyway, but he gets out all this gear to hang one thing on the wall. I took a picture and put it on Instagram when it happened. I think that's a little excessive, you know, personally. I disagree with his approach. Nobody is going to agree with someone 1,000% of the time. And if you did, that is frightening. I find that frightening. Whenever I come across anybody that's like, I don't disagree with this politician at all. Everything 100%. You're an alien. You're a Martian. That's weird. It's not normal. That's not normal. Stop it. It's healthy. We live in a republic. You should be encouraged to ask questions. You should be encouraged to be like, I don't like that. Because people died for your ability to say and not like it. So I don't agree with him on this. I still like him. He's still my pick in the primary, but I totally disagree with him on term limits. Now you might say, well, Dana, that's a smaller thing in context of, you know, all these other issues. It's actually not. I think it's actually a pretty big issue. The reason I say this is because think about how much special interests are going to be empowered. Just go back for a moment, if you will. Indulge me. Go back to 2010. Do you remember how many portions of that healthcare bill were alleged to have been written by lobbyists? Especially as it related to like R&D and what is it? The excise medical taxes and all that stuff. Excise tax on this. I mean, it was wild. All these different insurance lobbyists and everybody had a hand in the pot. And some of them were pushed away by more senior members in Congress who had been there and had the clout to do so and were trying to fight and scrape as much as possible. I mean, the Democrats ended up losing so big after this thing passed. But there were some Republicans in there that were fighting it. And I think had we a Republican majority, those senior members would have had more authority. But the makeup was as it was at the time. Now imagine having people in Congress that have zero clout, zero authority, and all the power rests with these lobbyists. That's what you're getting. So that's another thing to take into consideration where it concerns term limits.